The quintessential history painting that we're going to look at today can be labeled this painting by Charles Le Brun, who was in fact the court painter, the first painter to the king, Louis XIV of France, the Sun monarch, who was of course extremely important in the history of France. Charles Le Brun not only had that elevated position, but he also was one of the founders of the French Royal Academy, which established a system of regulations, guidelines, method of instruction for students at the Royal Academy, and also a series of regular exhibitions which would promote history painting and the kind of guidelines that the Royal Academy thought were important. So what makes a history painting a history painting? To use this as an example, we think, first of all, it has to encompass an actual historical event. So what is being shown here? Well, I'll give you the answer. This is a portrait of, or a scene of, Alexander the great Hellenistic ruler, and his general Hephaestion in 333 BCE, who has just conquered Darius, then ruler of Persia. And Darius escaped after the battle, which Alexander won, and Darius left to regroup his forces, leaving his family stranded, if you will. And they are here, suppliants before Alexander, awaiting his verdict, if you will. So that's the first thing that makes a history painting. It's an actual historical event. This is, in this case, to be honest with you, it could include an element from mythology or the Bible. It's a readable story. Some of the practitioners and theorists who set down the ideas that Le Brun put into actual practice, like Leonardo Battista Alberti in the 15th century Italy, decided that history painting was the most important category because it told about an actual history event and was in lofty terms, and it also was legible, because after all, if you're going to have something to say about a historical event or an actual event, it has to be read. I mean, there's no point in writing a novel or making a painting if you can't understand it. So let's parse this out. How do we know what's going on here? What kind of characteristics do you look at when you look at a painting of this sort, a figural composition? Very complicated, if you can put it that way. You might consider the placement of the figures in the painting. Where are they in relationship to the overall context? Where are they in relationship to each other? How big are they? That sometimes gives you an important indicator of who is in power, who is not. What about the costume? What are they wearing? How does that give us a clue about who they are? And of course, then there's the body language. We all know that people's gestures and facial expressions are very telling. Painters knew this too, of course, and they incorporated that clearly. In fact, here is, just to show you how important Le Brun was to Louis XIV, if you go to Versailles, and this is an image of the Hall of Mirrors, Le Brun's paintings are all over Versailles, including the Hall of Mirrors and elsewhere, for which this painting was actually commissioned in the first place by Louis XIV, just to give you a sense of the importance that a painter, first painter to the king like Le Brun, would have held. But let's look at some of the details. Here is one figure who is the primary kneeling figure right in front of the two standing figures. Some other details. And what Le Brun did was to categorize or systematize, if you will, a series of expressions and body postures, which he called expressions of passion. And here you can see some of his examples of anger, sadness, admiration, and so forth. And here are some more. Here is sadness, for instance, tearfulness, mirth, and so forth, anger. You can look at yourself in the mirror sometimes. It's sort of fun to see if you can imagine how to paint yourself in these postures. And to show you the importance of Le Brun's ideas about the categorization, an American painter of the 19th century, John Vanderlyn, also was very much aware of the importance of physiognomic studies, and here he is himself using the admiration, which is in reverse here, from his own drawing book. He obviously was very much aware of the dictums of Le Brun. So history painting, in thematic term, concerns a historically significant event with attention to historical truth. Now that could be modified in some way, but there is attention given to historical truth. So one of the characteristics that I'm going to label is historicity, and I think that's on the slide that's coming up. And it also requires, a history painting also requires narrativity, or the ability to tell a story in a convincing way, with one moment halted in time that suggests somehow a beginning, a middle, and an end, in a sort of cyclical fashion of history, with the past and the present connecting to each other. And it tells this story, as Alberti asks us to in the 15th century, through a noble composition and imposing figuration. Not just anybody or anything or anywhere, but making this important because of the manner in which it's represented. And I think you can get the sense of that painting here, that those ideas too, that these are nobly drawn figures in noble postures in a composition that makes us look at them interacting with each other and asks us to wonder what is going on, what is the message. This is what Le Brun would have called a fitting representation. It also is very large. This painting is 117 inches by 178 inches. And just to give you an example of a painting that you've probably seen, I think this is in the National Gallery. I'm not sure. It's Autumn Rhythm by Jackson Pollock, just to give you a sense of that scale. Pollock's is about the same size. It's a little bit wider than the Le Brun, but a little bit shorter. But it is not conceivably a history painting, but it is certainly of comparable scale. So there's another ingredient besides historicity, narrativity to history painting, and that is, as I think I suggested in terms of Alberti's own ideas and certainly Le Brun's ideas, it has to be of something important, that it has to convey something important to us, the viewer. Hence, it has to be readable, it has to be legible, and it has to do that with noble figuration. So Louis XIV commissioned this painting, as I said, and Louis would have understood and perhaps wanted, and undoubtedly wanted Le Brun to make a painting about the clemency of an all-powerful ruler to his subjects. So that's the point of this painting, and Le Brun makes it very clear what we are supposed to read in this, as you say, very accommodating gesture. I think you can get a sense now, perhaps, that why history painting was ranked highest. It placed the most technical demands on an artist. As I said, the painter had to be a figural painter, a figure painter of texture, materials, landscape, had to understand compositional problems, coloristic abilities. How your comment about the figure in gold is an telling one, I think, because that shows us the importance of this figure. So it required a lot of technical prowess, a lot of training on the hand of the artist to be able to create that ability. And we can see here some of the details. I just wanted to. Here is a drawing that Le Brun made separately for the head of Alexander. This kind of preparatory work was very much an important part of a history painter's instruction. And he even also conveys here the importance he gives to the gesture, modifying, figuring out which is the one that works best. But also, besides technical ability, a history painter had to be very well educated. They had to understand, in general, the milieu in which this event might have taken place. Who could have been the cast of characters? Who was there? Who would be likely to be there? How can you make this really an impactful figure? So the artist had to research this topic, besides using his own imagination, reading texts and so forth. And perhaps, and I'm not sure this is the case, since Alexander had long died when Le Brun was painting his work, he might have looked at images on coins, such as this one of Alexander as king and god on a image here that I show you. So a history painting showed off the erudition or learning of the artist and his technical prowess, and therefore conveyed important status. So everybody wanted to be a history painter. Nobody wanted to be a still life painter.